Hello viewers, so today I Shivika from Tirthankar Mahavir University present before you for reflecting the topic scoliosis. Yes, scoliosis, a very interesting topic of orthopedics. Today we are going to learn about this, and before proceeding to my topic, I would like to say thank you to the Regional Academy and Professional Training Institute for organizing such a beautiful platform for us and just giving an opportunity for sharing our knowledge with all of you. So here we go. Scoliosis. So here is the overview of the lectures. First is definition, types, clinical features, diagnosis, prognosis, and finally the treatment of scoliosis. So what is scoliosis? Scoliosis is basically the lateral curvature of the spine in upright position in coronal plane. It means when we divide the body into anterior and posterior half, the lateral curvature which we see in the posterior half is known as scoliosis. And when the curve is greater than 10 degrees, we classify it in the term scoliosis. It is apparent because of lateral curvature, the commonest form of scoliosis is always a triplanar deformity. Triplanar because in this the vertebral bones may rotate and it may laterally deviate, and it may also comes anterior-posteriorly. So it is also known as a triplanar deformity. It affects the spinal mechanics in following ways. First of all, it is a cosmetically unacceptable deformity. The second is it deranges the load and force transmission mechanisms through the spine. Obviously, it affects the center of gravity and the base of support of the body, and it deranges the load and force transmission. The third one is it geoparalyzes the functions of vital organs like lungs, heart, while overcrowding the ribs. The fourth point is managing it is cumbersome and unrewarding experience most of the times. It means the treatment is sometimes is very very difficult for scoliosis. So it is a very important categories of scoliosis, the types of scoliosis. The first one is non-structural scoliosis and the second one is structural scoliosis. Non-structural scoliosis also known as postural scoliosis because it is in the outside of the spine. Externally there is a problem, externally not internally. The second is structural scoliosis. In structural scoliosis we will learn about idiopathic scoliosis. The second one is osteopathic, that is congenital scoliosis. The third is paralytic scoliosis, that is myopathic. The fourth one is neuropathic and the fifth one is neurofibromatosis and the last one is miscellaneous group of connective tissue disorders that may contain multiple epiphyseal dysplasias, osteogenesis imperfecta, etc. So here is the general types of scoliosis. In the first figure you can see there is a healthy spine. The straight spine is healthy spine. In second figure you can clearly see the thoracic scoliosis because in this the thoracic vertebrae are affected only. The third is lumbar scoliosis and the fourth one is thoracolumbar scoliosis, and in the fifth and the final figure showing the combined scoliosis. So we are going to learn about non-structural scoliosis, that is also known as postural scoliosis. The deformity is secondary or compensatory to some condition outside the spine. The curves are flexible and readily correctable with side bending. It means when the patient comes to you and the curves are apparent to you, but when the patient side bends, the curve may become disappear. So it is a kind of postural scoliosis. It is actually a compensatory mechanism to the following conditions: LLD, leg length discrepancy, fixed flexion deformity of the hip, that is compensatory scoliosis, local inflammation or irritation due to acute lumbar disc disease, prolapsed disc, that is sciatic scoliosis, and the poor postural habits is known as postural scoliosis. So here is the figure. In the first figure, you can see a young girl who is standing, and the curves are apparent. But when the this girl may forward bend, the curves may become disappear. So this is basically a postural type of scoliosis. And in the second figure, you can see a girl who have a difference of lower limb length. Basically, she is a patient of limb length discrepancy, and when she sits, ultimately the curve is disappear. In the third figure and then the last figure, you can see the sciatic scoliosis, which disappear when the prolapse disc settle down or removed. So here are the three examples of the postural scoliosis. The first one is we can say the postural scoliosis, and the second one is the LLD scoliosis, and the third one is sciatic scoliosis. So here also some figures which beautifully define the postural scoliosis. In the first figure, you can easily see the vertebral bones. There is the center of gravity line which is passing in between, but in the later curvature in scoliosis, the center of gravity may deviate. That is also known as compensatory scoliosis. In the second figure, you can see in case of LLD, the pelvic side shift to one side, and there may be development of scoliosis. And in the third figure, you can see the sciatic scoliosis due to the pain. So here is our second type of scoliosis, the structural scoliosis. The curves are fixed and non-flexible and fail to correct with side bending. That is non-correctable. It means the patient आपके पास आएगा and it may do side bending or we can say forward bending, तो हमारा curve जो होगा disappear नहीं रहेगा. It may remain in the position जो आप उसको upright position में देख रहे हैं, वही position में curve रहेगा. Lateral bending of spine is asymmetric or involved vertebral are fixed in a rotated position or both. And the essential component is vertebral rotation. The spinous processes swing round towards the concavity of the curve, and transfer processes on the convexity rotate posteriorly. In thoracic region, the ribs on the convex side stand out prominently, producing the rib hump. Rib hump is basically the prominent feature of the scoliosis when the patient forward bend. It comes under Adams test. Here in this first figure, you can easily see the Adams test. Therapist is observing the rib hump when the patient forward bend. And in the second figure, you can see with the help of scoliometer, we are measuring the curvature of the spine. So, in structural scoliosis, the first one is idiopathic scoliosis. The cause is unknown. Most common type of scoliosis, that is 3 per 1000. Population incidence series curves is greater than 30 degree and therefore needing treatment. Trivial curves are much more common, occurs in any age but usually appears clinically between 10 to 13 years. More common in females. Usually asymptomatic and is usually accidentally discovered. The age at onset has been used to define three groups, that is adolescent, juvenile and infantile. Basically it is the previous classification of idiopathic scoliosis, but now it has been modified by early onset and late onset. Early onset is just before the puberty and the late onset is after the puberty. So now we will learn about the classifications of idiopathic scoliosis. Okay, so the first one is late onset, that is adolescent idiopathic scoliosis. The age group is 10 or above 10. Commonness type, mostly seen in girls. Primary thoracic curves are usually convex to the right, lumbar curves to the left, intermediate thoracolumbar and combined, that is double primary curves also occur. Progression is inevitable. Mostly curves is less than 20 degrees, either resolve spontaneously or remain unchanged. It means we know we don't want a proper treatment for late onset idiopathic scoliosis. It may resolve naturally. The reliable predictors of progressions are a very young age, marked curvature and incomplete riser sign at presentation. So here you can see the idiopathic scoliosis. The riser score, we can investigate it with the help of riser score. Riser score is just in this we can basically see the skeletal maturity of iliac crest bone. So here is the five grades in the riser scores. The zero is the no ossification and the five is the complete ossification. Similarly, it may increase from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and the five comes to a stage in which there is a complete ossification of the bone. That is the riser score. So here is the treatment of idiopathic scoliosis. First we have to do preliminary observation of patient before deciding between conservative and operative treatment. So first of all obviously we will have to decide ki hum log conservatively management uska kar sakte hain physiotherapy se ya other koi therapies se ya fir we only need a operative treatment, that is a surgery for the scoliosis. At 4 to 9 months intervals, the patient is examined, photographed and x-rayed so that curves can be measured and checked for progression. At 4 to 9 months, hum log us patient ko appointment denge ki he may come and just go for x-ray so we can see the progression of the disease. Non-operative treatment. In non-operative treatment, basically we may involve exercises, maintain muscle tone and for inspire confidence. Bracing for progressive scoliosis curve between 20 to 30 degree. Milwaukee brace and Boston brace with additional corrective pads may be used and it may be worn for 23 hours out of 24 hours. You also have to tell the duration to the patient that you have to wear 23 hours from 24 hours, basically for the whole day. Actually, bracing will not improve the curve, only it stops from getting it worse. So we go to the corrective surgery in this condition. Here you can see the very important orthotics for the scoliosis. The first one is Milwaukee brace and the second one is Boston brace. It is basically spinal orthosis which we prescribed in case of scoliosis. So what is the operative treatment for idiopathic scoliosis? For curves greater than 30 degrees, especially in pre-pubertal children, and for balanced double primary curves, surgical options may include Harrington system, rod and some laminar wiring, that is Locu system, and the third one is Cottrell Dowsett system, and the fourth and the last one is anterior instrumentation, that is costoplasty for rib hump. So here you can see the Harrington system. the ODE, original system. Basically, all the system are arise from the Harrington system. In this, we apply a rod posteriorly along the concave side of the curve. Attached to the rod were movable hooks that were engaged in the uppermost and lowermost vertebra to distract the curve. बेसिकली जो हमारा कर्व कॉन्वे कॉन्केव साइड है, हम उसमें एक रॉड फिट कर देंगे जिससे वो कर्व हमारा स्ट्रेट हो जाएगा. डैट इज स्ट्रेट मीन्स अ हेल्थी स्पाइन. एंड वी अप्लाई हुक्स एंड स्क्रूज टू फिक्स दिस प्रॉब्लम. बट देयर इज अ मेजर डिसएडवांटेज ऑफ हैरिंगटन सिस्टम. डैट इज इट डज नॉट करेक्ट द रोटेशनल डिफॉर्मिटी. द रिप प्रोमिनेंस रिमेन्स अनचेंज्ड. So here is our second surgical option, that is the rod and sublaminar wiring, that is a LUQ system. It is basically a modified Harrington system. The wires are passed under vertebral lamina at multiple levels and fixed to the rod at concave side of curve, provides more control, secure fixation. And it also contains a disadvantage because the wires are dangerously close to the dura, that is the brain covering the meninges, the dura mater, and it increases the risk of neurological damage. The third is the Cottrell-Dowsett system. This method combines a pedicle screw box foundation at the caudal end of deformity with multiple hooks placed at various levels to produce either distraction or compression. Using double rods can distract on the concave and compress on the convex side of the curve. Claim that this method can correct rotational deformity as well. It is sufficiently rigid to make post-operative bracing unnecessary. So it is a very improved version of the surgical treatments. Anterior instrumentation. This method approaches the spine from the front. Okay, so all the options are just from posteriorly, but this is the first method in which we are operating from anteriorly. It removes the disc and throughout the curve and then apply a compressive device along convex side of curve. Bone grafts added to achieve fusion. And a major advantage of the anterior instrumentation is that it provides strong fixation with less vertebral segment to be fused, and there may be also lesser risk of cord injury. So it is very safe for the neurological point of view. So here you can see the surgery. There is we have just performed the spinal fusion. A steel rod helps support the fusion of the vertebra, and bone grafts are placed to grow into the bone and fuse the vertebra. So, but there may be also some complications of surgery which may involve neurological compromise. It may some spinal cord nerves are just damaged during surgery, or it may impinge, spinal cord may be damaged, and the spinal decompensation, pseudoarthrosis, it means some fibrosis, the fall joints are formed due to this surgery, and the fourth and the last one is implant failure. So the next is the second type of the idiopathic scoliosis after late onset is the early onset juvenile idiopathic scoliosis. It is uncommon, presenting in children with age 4 to 9 years. Characteristics are similar to adolescent group, but prognosis is worse and surgical correction is necessary before puberty. However, if the child is very young, a brace may hold the curve stationary until the age of 10 years when fusion is more likely to succeed. It means agar hamare paas patient aayega 4 to 9 years, so we have to just wait up to 10 years. Hum log yahi prescribe karenge ki hum wait kare, then we will perform the surgery. It is rare, presenting in children aged 3 or under 3 years old, mostly seen in boys, and most curves are thoracic with convexity to the left. Mostly infantile curves resolve instantaneously. Progressive curves can become very severe. Those in which the rib vertebral angle at the apex of the curves differs on the two sides by more than 20 degrees are likely to deteriorate. That is a cardiopulmonary dysfunction, because when the curves goes on higher and higher, of course our ribs got deviated, and our heart there may be extra pressure on our heart and lungs. Treated by applying serial elongation, derotation, flexion, plaster cast under general anesthesia. If up to 4 years ka progression not slows down, surgical correction is required. This takes the forms of anterior disc excision and fusion to control apex of curve, combined with posterior fusion to prevent posterior overgrowth. So here you can see the infantile scoliosis in children. The next is osteopathic, that is congenital scoliosis from the genetics, from mother and father. Due to fracture and bone softening, rickets, or in osteogenesis imperfecta, rickets, you can easily know the deficiency of vitamin D in children, and in osteogenesis imperfecta, genetically hamari bones achhi tarike se develop nahi hai, so there may be chances of osteopathic scoliosis. Due to vertebral anomaly like hemivertebra, wedged vertebra, fused vertebra, sometimes combined with absence of fused ribs, overlying tissues often show angiomas, navy, excess hairs, dimples, or a pad of fat, spina bifida, and visceral anomalies are common. Advanced imaging required to rule out dysraphism, particularly diastematomyelia and cord tethering prior to curve correction. Treat in special units. The approach is to undertake stage dissection of curve's apex, followed by instrumentation and spinal fusion. Here you can see the hemivertebra shape of the vertebral bones, that is fully segmented, and the blocked vertebra in osteopathic scoliosis. After idiopathic and osteogenesis imperfecta, or we can say in the osteogenesis imperfecta scoliosis, the third is paralytic scoliosis due to muscle imbalance on either side of trunk. Basically, our motor system is involved in paralytic scoliosis, so there may be muscle imbalances on the either side of trunk, and basically seen in muscular dystrophies and in muscular AMC, that is amyotrophic muscular diseases. The next is neuropathic. It includes spinal cord injury, poliomyelitis, progressive neurological disorders, syringomyelia, myelingomeningocele, Friedreich ataxia, rarer lower neuromotor neuron diseases, and CP patients. Paralytic curve is long, convex toward weaker muscle side, and treatment by suitable sitting support and by stabilization of entire paralyzed segment by a combined anterior and posterior instrumentation and fusion. So in this, basically we perform the anterior and posterior instrumentation surgery for neuropathic diseases. Basically in this the nerves are involved. Here you can see the neuromuscular scoliosis, and the last one which we are going to discuss about scoliosis is the neurofibromatosis scoliosis. So the last one is neurofibromatosis. About 1/3 of patients of neurofibromatosis develops spinal deformity. Severity varies from mild to mostly marked, accompanied by skin lesions, multiple neurofibromatoma, and bony dystrophy affecting vertebra and ribs. Curve is short and sharp in neurofibromatosis. You have to just mind it. You have to just note in this this point in your mind, that this curve is short and sharp in neurofibromatosis. The mild cases are treated like idiopathic scoliosis, and the severe cases needs combined anterior and posterior instrumentation and fusion. So here is the clinical features, that is a very important topic for the category of scoliosis. So first one is deformity, the skew back and the rib hump. स्क्यू बैक इज बेसिकली द ए सिमेट्री, द स्क्यू स्क्यू वर्ड का जो हमारा मीनिंग है वो हमारे ए सिमेट्री ऑफ स्पाइन है. सो देर में भी ए सिमेट्री ऑफ स्पाइन एंड देर में भी रिब हम्प. रिब हम्प वी कैन सी रिब हम्प इन एडम्स टेस्ट व्हेन द पेशेंट फॉरवर्ड बेंड एंड यू कैन सी द रिब हम्प क्लियरली. सो इट इज दिस टेस्ट इज नोन एज एडम्स टेस्ट. Deviated spine becomes apparent during bending, that is Adam's test. The pain, rare complaint and give possibility for a neural tumor and the need for MRI. Children have painless deformity. Yes, the children have painless deformity of scoliosis. There may be chances of family history in case of congenital scoliosis, abnormality during pregnancy or childbirth, early developmental milestones should be noted. Skin pigmentation and congenital anomalies such as sacral dimples or ear tufts are also sought. Breast, shoulders and iliac crests are asymmetrical in case of scoliosis. Excessive kyphosis or lordosis may be seen. LLD may be possible in non-structural scoliosis or we can say in case of postural scoliosis, which we have discussed earlier. So there is a girl, the small girl who is suffering from scoliosis, and in this figure we can see all the basically majorly all the clinical features of scoliosis. The head is slightly shift off center, there is uneven shoulders, larger gap on one side between arm and wrist, one hip is higher than the other, the uneven shoulders. The shoulder blade higher than the others. You can see the prominent scapular region, the medial border of scapula is more prominent than the other side scapula. Asymmetry of back and visible curves. The other signs may be rib prominence when bending over, cloths not hanging properly. It means the patient come to you with a hanging cloths, with a hanging outfit, okay? Asymmetry of ribs, chest, etc. So, diagnosis, or we can say the investigations. Imaging. Posterior anterior view of spine, standard lateral radiography of spine, right and left bending films of spine, and sternal derotation view, hum log isme karenge in scoliosis, and the following radiological parameters should be checked. This is the basically pinpoint investigations for scoliosis. The first one is Cobb's method to measure severity of curve for determining angle of curve. The second is Nash and Moss method to measure vertebral rotation, that is spinal process and periodical position. The third one is Reiser's sign for determining curve progression. We have learned about Reiser's sign, in which we see the skeletal maturity of the iliac crest, and there may be 0 to 5 grades, and the ossifications are going from mild to moderate. So Reiser's sign ke bare mein hum log already pad chuke hain, aur aage hum further diagnosis investigations ke bare mein padhenge in detail. And the last one is rib angle of Mehta for measuring RVAD. सो हेयर इज़ द कॉब्स एंगल. ठीक है, सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल जो हमारे स्पाइन है, आप लोग फर्स्ट वी आर क्लियर दैट द स्ट्रेट स्पाइन इज हेल्थी स्पाइन. नाउ वी हैव टू लर्न अबाउट कॉब्स एंगल. बेसिकली द लाइन्स व्हेन वी ड्रॉ फ्रॉम द अवर वर्टिब्रल बोन्स आर जस्ट पैरेलल टू ईच अदर, बट इन केस ऑफ स्कोलियोसिस व्हेन वी मेजर अ एंगल फ्रॉम द मोस्ट डेविएटेड वर्टिब्रल बोन in the higher and the lower segment, there may be the lines may cross and make an angle. So this angle is known as Cobb's angle. Basically जो हमारी सबसे ऊपर जो vertebral bone जो deviate and सबसे जो नीचे हमारा bone है जो laterally deviate है vertebral bone in the curve, जो इन दोनों के बीच में जो हम लोग line draw करेंगे and there may be formation of a angle is known as Cobb's angle. That is a very important angle in which we measure in scoliosis. In the next figure you can see the angle measurement of rib hump. You can use a scoliometer for this, for measuring the rib hump, or you can also perform Adam's test for performing this. So here is the Nash and Moss method, which is also a very important investigation of the scoliosis. In this, we can see the pedicle positions. Okay, so in there are basically five grades for Nash and Moss method. The first one is neutral. The pedicle both on the concave side and on the convex side are on its position. Okay, in the first positive grade, the pedicle start disappearing. On the right side pedicle, you can clearly see it's going on disappearing. And in the left side pedicle, it may shift towards midline. And in the second grade, that is two positive, the our right side pedicle going on disappearing, and on the left side pedicle, it's comes into the midline. In three positive, you can clearly see the pedicle has become disappear, and in the left side, the pedicle comes in the middle, and in the last grade, that is four positive grade, the left side pedicle goes on the right side, and in the right side pedicle has become disappear. So basically, it's showing the curvature of the spine कि वो कैसे shift होता जा रहा है towards other side. Okay. So here you can easily diagnose the scoliosis with the help of Nash and Moss method. That is a very popular method which we perform in. So here is the spatial imaging for scoliosis. That is CT and MRI for rule out vertebral abnormality or cord compression. We can also perform pulmonary function test for showing marked reduction in vital capacity of the patient. Patient with muscular dystrophies or connective tissue disorders requires full biochemical or neuromuscular investigations of underlying condition. The compensation formation of curves in the opposite direction is called compensation. When we have just two curves in the back side of the patient, it is known as compensation. The angle of the secondary curve should be equal to that of the primary curve. If it exceeds, called overcompensation. So basically हमारे दोनों कर्व्स इक्वल होते हैं, बट इफ़ वन कर्व हमारे रेडी द सेकेंडरी कर्व इज मोर देन द प्राइमरी कर्व, वी कैन कॉल्ड इट ओवर कंपनसेशन. सो नाउ प्रोग्नोसिस ऑफ स्कोलियोसिस. प्रोग्नोसिस इज द की टू ट्रीटमेंट. द एम इज टू प्रिवेंट सीवियर डिफॉर्मिटी. द यंगर द चाइल्ड, द हायर द कर्व, द वर्स इज द प्रोग्नोसिस. यस, यू हैव टू जस्ट पिन पॉइंट दिस लाइन. द यंगर द चाइल्ड, द लेस द एज ऑफ द चाइल्ड, द हायर द कर्व, द वर्स इज द प्रोग्नोसिस, एंड साइमल्टेनियसली द वर्स इज द ट्रीटमेंट. देर में बी मोर देर में बी लेस चांसेस ऑफ सर्वाइवल फ्रॉम स्कॉलियोसिस. मैनेजमेंट वेरीज विद दीज टाइप्स ऑफ स्कॉलियोसिस. ट्रीटमेंट डिपेंड्स ऑन एज ऑफ पेशेंट एंड सीवियरिटी ऑफ कर्व. अर्ली डिटेक्शन ऑफ कर्व मीन्स आप लोग जितनी जल्दी डायग्नोस हम लोग कर लेते हैं स्कॉलियोसिस की, पेशेंट इज सफरिंग फ्रॉम डैट, सो इट्स मोर इजी फॉर द डॉक्टर्स टू कंपनसेट द दिस डिफॉर्मिटी. द फर्स्ट वन इज नॉन सर्जिकल ट्रीटमेंट. ऑब्जर्वेशन इज द प्राइमरी ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ ऑल कर्व्स एट प्रेजेंट. रेडियोग्राफी इज द ओनली डेफिनेट डॉक्यूमेंटेशन ऑफ कर्व साइज एंड प्रोग्रेशन. डैट वी हैव जस्ट लर्न अबाउट नैश एंड मोस मैथड, कर्व्स मैथड, एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा. सो इन द सेकेंड वी हैव जस्ट द ऑर्थोटिक ट्रीटमेंट. डैट इज वेरी इफेक्टिव इन स्केलेटली इमेच्योर पर्सन, एंड वी प्रेस्क्राइब्स मिल्वॉकी ब्रेसी, बोस्टन ब्रेसेस, कैरिस्टन ब्रेस, प्राइजर्स, टर्न बकल कास्ट, लोकलाइजर कास्ट एक्सेट्रा आर यूज, एंड द 20 डिग्री लेवल इज कंसिडर स्टिल फॉर ब्रेसिंग. अदर नॉन ऑपरेटिव ट्रीटमेंट इंक्लूड्स एक्सरसाइजिज एंड इलेक्ट्रिकल स्टिमुलेशन विच कंटेन्स मसल स्टिमुलेटर, एंड वी कैन से मिरर थेरेपी एक्सरसाइजिज. दैट इज वेरी इफेक्टिव फॉर स्कोलियोसिस. हैव बीन अनसक्सेसफुली ट्राइड इन एडोलसेंट वेराइटी. ट्रैक्शन इट हेल्प्स टू स्ट्रेच द कॉन्ट्रैक्टिव स्ट्रक्चर प्रायोर टू सर्जरी methods could be either non-skeletal or skeletal. Skeletal traction is provided by hello pelvic or hello femoral tractions. The surgical treatment, it is indicated for high degree thoracic curves which is inflexible, matlab it is structural scoliosis, not postural scoliosis, and is associated with secondary changes in the ribs. Casts are not effective in thoracic spine. Spinal surgery is also indicated when the curve is over 60 degrees, that is a very severe stage of scoliosis, and it aims at obtain fusion at the spine. So here is the flow chart showing methods of scoliosis treatment. It is a summarized method. The first, the method basically divided into two types. That is, first one is the destruction techniques, and the second one is the surgical fusion. In destruction techniques, we just rarely use the destruction techniques. Spinal instrumentation and spinal cord monitoring have been developed in destruction techniques, and the method involves which we have just learned earlier, that is hello pelvic and hello femoral destructions. And what are the indications for that, for performing destruction techniques? Kyphosis, rigid scoliosis greater than 100 degree, salvage procedure following failed spinal surgery, unstable spine due to laminectomy. And now we are going toward the second method, the surgical fusion. And what are the indications for that? If we are too late for prescribing orthosis for the scoliosis patient, that is Milwaukee braces, Boston braces, and there may be greater than 50 years, greater than 50 degree curves, failure to respond to Milwaukee brace, curves is greater than 60 degree, pain in adults, paralytic and congenital scoliosis. And the methods, of course we learn about that, that is anterior and posterior fusions. In posterior fusion there may be Harrington system, the Dialer instrumentation system, the Zilke instrumentation, the Hatchell rings, and the segmental Dvoucet system. So here is our two main important techniques for overcome the scoliosis, the destruction technique and the surgical fusion. So here is a short summary of the treatment. For congenital scoliosis, we go for surgery or for bracing. If the curve is very less than 20 degree, we can prescribe orthosis to the patient, and the curves may resolve spontaneously. But when the curve is more than 60 degree and there may be more severe scoliosis, we can go for surgery, that is anterior and posterior instrumentation, and further the fusion of the spine. The next is paralytic, that is myopathic scoliosis. Wheelchair sitting system may prescribe to the patient bracing surgery. And the third is idiopathic, in which we don't know the cause, and it is very common in children's. So observation of curve is less than 20 degree. Orthosis for curve for greater than 20 to 50 degrees, and operation. We can go for surgery only when the curve is greater than 50 degree, or we can say greater than 60 degree. So less than 20 degree pe you have to just observe and just prescribe orthosis and just easy exercises to the patient. And when the curve is between 20 to 50 degree, simultaneously again orthosis. And for curves greater than 50 degree, you have to just perform surgery. There is no other alternative treatment for that. Marked rotation is overcome by bracing. Degenerative changes in less than 60 years, you can do posture correction exercises and corsets, etc. And in the greater than 60 years patient, in geriatrics population, you can go for surgery. Alternative therapies involve exercises, electrical stimulation, muscle stimulators, biofeedback, tractions, manipulations, etc. So here is a summarized treatment of the scoliosis. Hope this may be clear to you, and you get something by this lecture. Thank you.